tell me confounded between Freddie Washington and Louise Beaver. Beavers, which raises some response to your question. They do a film together called Imitation of Life.
Imitation of White?
Imitation of Life.
Life.
But you're right.
Yeah, it sounds about
Freddie Washington was a very light complexion woman. She was so light complexion that they had to put brown face makeup on her when she starred in the role earlier, 1933, with Paul Robeson called Amber Jones. When he looked at the dailies, Paul Robeson was grabbing a white woman on the screen. So they said, hold everything, let's put some makeup on this child. The next year, her light complexion pays off for her in terms of this film, Imitation of Life, a bestseller in 1933, is taken over to be filmed in 34. And it's about the Depression. It's about two single mothers who bond together to construct a family, an economic unit. One of the families is white, the other is black. Both mothers have a daughter. And the black mother has a pancake formula, which the white mother packages and becomes a multimillionaire on the basis of it. But they all live together as this transformation is taking place. Freddie Washington's character, Piola, wants the privileges of whiteness as she achieves adulthood. She doesn't want to go to a Negro college. She doesn't want to date Negro men. And in the original novel, she sterilizes herself, marries a white man, and moves to Bolivia. But in the film, they wanted a different kind of ending. So she abandons her mother, tells her mother, don't talk to me if you see me on the street, because I'm becoming a white woman. Right. Now, let's go behind the scenes. The relationship between the two actresses. The dark mammy figure, Louise Beavers, and the mulatta figure, Freddie Washington. Freddie Washington organizes the first Black Actors Guild. Right? And when they confront her with the obvious anti-Negro of not her character, because black audiences love her character, despite the fact the character is striving to become a white person legally, but that of the mammy figure. And she said, you leave that woman alone, Louise Beavers, who was the second most popular mammy in American film in the 1930s, 1940s, and early 1950s, Hattie McDaniel being the most popular. But Louise Beavers, Freddie Washington said, in all my opposition to this kind of material, this kind of anti-black material, I understand that Louise Beavers is in fact, she's captured into an industry which only allows her to be this. Right? I can leave film and go back to the theater. She can't. Now, for a time, Freddie Washington was the sister-in-law of Adam Clayton Powell Jr. And Adam Clayton Powell Jr. published out of Harlem a newspaper, a weekly newspaper called The People's Voice, I think it was called. And Freddie wrote a column in that paper in which he attacked the United States' Army's military segregation, she attacked the USO, she attacked black comedians who played the minstrel part. So in a sense, she took advantage of the semiotics of the mulatto and turned it into an aggressive, radical, so I hope that gives you some sense of the kinds of possibilities that I have.
I actually wanted to return to the early 20th century and your question, Professor Wilkerson. And I just thought I should throw it out there that, you know, an interesting unit to think about in terms of black regiments in the late 19th, early 20th century is the 24th Battalion, which formed a significant part of the Smoke Yankees. Prior to that, they were also stationed in Cuba. They were sent on the Pershing expedition to find Pancho Villa, and they ended up in 1917 in Houston, part of the Houston Mutiny, where a number of the soldiers, you know, it's all black regiment turned the
country. Were some of them captured
by Villa? I'm looking into that. my question, though, is about the deployment of film in this period in the early 20th century, because you know, I've been thinking a lot about this period and the different ways that films were used or not used. For example, Birth of a Nation was shown to different all-black regiments on the U.S.-Mexico border, sometimes as a disciplinary measure and sometimes deliberately not shown in order to, you know, ensure a different kind of authority for black soldiers. In Forgeries, you write about William Randolph Hearst's production of Patria, where he was encouraging other industrial capitalists to support an intervention into Mexico.
Yeah.
But prior to that, actually the film that gets released before Birth of a Nation is D.W. Griffith's The Life of General Villa, which is this very positive depiction of Pancho Villa. And it's the first film I think actually saw a shot on a battlefield.
Yeah.
So I'm really interested in whether, I think when we think about film and film showing and the kind of disciplinary measures, it's functioning, you know, it's a kind of anachronistic thinking. You know, we imagine the way we go to movies, we imagine the way we experience film. But if you think about this earlier period when you didn't have the same kind of access, and in fact showing or not showing, you know, could be used for very specific functionings, I was just wondering, I have so many questions about that, but I was just wondering in the research if how you were thinking about the kind of unevenness of just the film showing itself and you know, what sort of consequences that had to the unevenness of racial regimes being deployed in different movies sometimes being shown at the same period.
Yeah. Well, you remember that I printed in the book advertisement from an Atlantic Constitution newspaper in 1950 for The Birth of a Nation, right, is a main draw, and underneath it is an invitation to a Klan rally. Organizing, not a Klan rally, but organizing an event. There are so many things happening to immigrants and poor whites in this period that make a film like The Birth of a Nation imperative to their future. the Rockefellers are behind the white slavery crisis. The Rockefellers are behind the sterilization program for poor white women. They are under siege, in which the notion is implied by most film historians that seeing Birth of a Nation is persuasive because it, in effect, fulfills a desire for acceptance and identification, is not to take account of the extraordinary pressures under this immigrant population, that were employed on this immigrant population. This immigrant population, you know, there's like, what is the figure, 20 million between 1890 and 1920? Half of the white population in the United States, according to the 1980 census, were descended from this immigration wave. So the Birth of a Nation is, I think, not the exuberant and exorbitant premiere in Los Angeles in February of 1915, or in New York, or at the White House, et cetera, et cetera, but a kind of unadulterated Birth of a Nation without the orchestra playing, the symphony written for it, et cetera, but in these small theaters, et cetera. So I think it's a very important research topic. It's an under-researched subject, how the film was received. But the point is that there were agencies outside of Griffith and Dixon, which made this film exceedingly, what's the term, exceedingly critical to, you know, to that majority immigrant population that we're seeing.